कौन है ये नया चेहरा इन HopStart? Hi guys, this is me, Bhavya Sharma, और अब मैं आपकी हूँ HopStart की पार्टनर. And guess where are we today? We are at CP Kukreja Architects, where we're going to find lots and lots about the field of architecture as a thriving profession. So, what are you waiting for? Come on!
Hi, I'm Dikshu Kukreja from CP Kukreja Architects. I'm the managing principal here. We are Delhi based and we have an international presence as well.
Can you tell us a little about your company and what's the journey been like so far?
Sure. First of all, it's a pleasure to be with you guys, and it's such a wonderful initiative, and I look forward to having this information shared with your Gen X or Gen Y, it would be, yeah, to get to know more about the career in architecture. Our firm, CP Kukreja Architects, is a firm which has now 200 professionals, and we have an office here in Delhi as well as in New York. The firm has lots of architects, interior designers, graphic designers and engineers as well. And it started actually 50 years ago. Mr. CP Kukreja, my father, was the founder of this firm, and he started what was at that time a modest two-man practice. And he was a young man in his early 30s, and he won a big competition, which was the biggest project of that time in India to happen, which was the design of the Jawaharlal Nehru University in Delhi.
Wow.
So once he won that competition, it was he suddenly shot into prominence, and then he started delivering successfully one after the other projects. And from there, the firm has grown to what it is today, where we have 200 people, and we are ranked consistently amongst the top 100 architects in the world and top 5 in Central Asia. So
fantastic.
Yes, it's been a wonderful journey and something we really cherish.
So in any success story, we always know there are milestones, there's always a breakthrough moment. So for your firm, what was it like?
So the breakthrough moment undoubtedly was the winning of the competition for the design of the Jawaharlal Nehru University. Because in that, through that win, through that competition design project that our firm won, we were able to enter into the limelight of being a prominent architecture firm. Till then we had been doing projects like residences and, you know, smaller scale projects. Those are important as well, of course, but smaller scale projects. So that was a breakthrough moment for the firm. The next breakthrough moment for the firm was when Mr. Kukreja came up with this unique idea, which was the first of its kind at that time, to actually go ahead and open international offices. So we are talking about the mid 70s when there was an oil boom in the Middle East, and he went on to open 13 offices in different states and different cities in,
wow,
the Middle East. So that was the second breakthrough moment. The third breakthrough moment, I think there were a few, of course, smaller breakthrough moments,
right,
but the third milestone in the journey was that I came back to and joined this practice in 1997, and then 5 years later we entered another very prominent national competition, which was for the design of the Gautam Buddha University, and we went on to win that competition,
mm-hmm,
and further went on to successfully design that university, which today is ranked amongst the 10 best designed in the world, best designed universities, in the where in the list you find Harvard, Yale, Oxford, Cambridge, and this one university from India. So that has been very satisfying.
You can, I think, very successfully now prefix a best among like all the titles that you guys have won so far. The one thing I'm sure you have been asked quite often, which is after your father passed away last year, what was it like filling into his shoes?
So, fitting into his shoes is something I guess will be a lifelong endeavor. When I can actually fit into them, I'm not sure. But he has been such a genius, such an icon, such a unique personality. He has so many firsts attached to him that he is unmatchable in those respects. But having said that, I think what he did, which was at that time when I was a young guy, like maybe a lot of your audience watching this might be, I used to find it absolutely terrifying and something I really resisted being a young 20-year-old or 22-year-old, which was that my father made me literally walk through fire. He made me go through lots of tests. He gave me a very hard time. He wanted me to prove myself on every little aspect of this profession. So I found that a little rough at that time. later in life, I realized that he did the best thing he could do for me, because it allowed me, because I'm in a profession, and correct, unless you become a good professional, you can never succeed or be successful. So he allowed me to walk that because he wanted me to be sure that A, I'm capable of it, and B, I can deliver to my clients. So that was the journey. And then having come back after spending time in Europe and in US, when I came back and joined this firm, again, it was a journey where I started really at the bottom in this firm. So I was just confined to one corner in a studio, and I worked there for literally 2 years.
It's very interesting that you spoke about this yourself. In fact, I was just going to ask you, was there any formal education which you had particularly done for this? And people especially who are aspiring to do this would love to know about it.
So, of course, the formal training or formal education was, of course, my architectural degrees. So first I took a degree in Bachelor in Architecture. I always wanted to be an architect. And maybe this is again something which between my father and me, that growing up as a school kid, he always used to question this idea that why would you want to be an architect?
Correct.
You don't need to be an architect. So that made me even more determined that I must prove that I want to and I'm capable to be one.
Right.
So I was very clear that I wanted to be an architect. So when I went into high school, I thought that I want to go to Europe, which I've always loved, and study in Italy, kind of a mecca of architecture. So I learned the Italian language for 4 years and almost decided to go there. But then I was fortunate to get into School of Planning and Architecture in Delhi. So somewhere I felt that maybe, with the kind of resources that I wanted even my parents to spend on my education, that it would be sensible to study, do undergrad in India, and then go further for further studies. So I did my undergraduation here. And then from there on, after doing the undergraduate degree, I applied to what is a unique institution in the US. It's called the Frank Lloyd Wright School of Architecture, after the famous Frank Lloyd Wright, the architect on whose personality the book Fountainhead, which many of us have read, is modeled. So Frank Lloyd Wright has this institute in the US, which has a unique setting where you have only 35 students from around the world and 35 faculty members.
Okay.
So it's just 70 people there. I was fortunate I got through.
Was there like an entrance which you had to crack to sort of get into this?
So yes, they do have an entrance, but it's a very selective process where they see your personality and your skills, and then they select you. So it's not like a written examination or anything like that.
Right.
So I was very fortunate to get through that. And the philosophy or mantra of that institution is learning by doing. So everything that you learn is by doing it yourself. So there, we were not just in a design studio drawing things, but we were also supposed to work in the kitchen. We were supposed to do gardening, construction maintenance.
Holistic training.
So that was a great foundation for me, a really defining moment in my life. And then while I was there, I had applied to other schools of architecture, some prominent universities. I was fortunate to make through them because I did reasonably well in my academics in School of Planning and Architecture, and I was a gold medalist. So I got through Harvard University and I went to the Graduate School of Design at Harvard. So that was again a fabulous experience where I was amongst a group of 26 students, out of which 22 were international students. There were only 4 Americans. So again, there was a lot of learning by just sheer interaction.
Absolutely. So I see it is a beautiful office. Would you mind if you have a look at it?
Of course not. Please, by all means, it would be great to walk you through the office.
Yes, let's show our viewers the office then.
Sure, let's do that.
Sir, experience over on the job training that one gets or the qualification, which one do you think weighs heavier?
So in our profession, I think it's a mix of both. But our profession is very interesting, that it is a blend of being on the creative side, creative bent of mind, artistic, and yet it's very technical also. It's not just pure art.
Right.
So therefore, I think an academic training is irreplaceable and absolutely essential, followed by a hands-on experience, which is very, very essential. Like it used to be in olden times in our line, where you were an apprentice and a guru attached to another guru, that kind of a thing.
Right.
So that is, experience is very important as well.
So would you recommend internships and training in the nascent stage?
It's actually part of the academic curriculum. If you have to get a degree in architecture, it's a five-year program. A BArch degree is typically in India a five-year program. And out of that five-year, one semester is practical training. Some schools, we call them schools actually, what I refer to is a college of architecture, but somehow this language globally for architecture is it's called school of architecture.
Correct.
When you're doing your degree. It is, in some of them, it's a full 1 year of apprenticeship. But in most others, it's 6 months. So it is part of your academic curriculum.
Okay. And what sort of skill sets do you think people should have, you know, in order to excel in this field?
So because this field is a mix of art and science,
right.
So in that sense, I always guide or my piece of advice to young aspiring architects is that either which you are good at allows you to eventually excel in this profession. So even if you are very artistic, very creative, very free-flowing mind, you can be a great architect. On the other side of the spectrum, if you're very technical minded, very strong in physics and mathematics, and you have a very technical mind, you can again be an excellent architect.
Right.
So what actually you need is you need to have an open mind, you need to have great observation skills, you need to be, what I strongly believe in, is very passionate.
Okay.
So if you have those skills, either end of the spectrum, creative or scientific, whichever you might be, you can be a good architect. Because the other thing about architecture, it's not a solo show. It's about a team spirit.
Absolutely.
You cannot deliver a building unless you have engineers and other professionals working with you. So as long as you have that leadership skill and the ability to lead the team, you could be great in creativity or you could be great in your scientific temperament. You can excel in this field.
But I'm sure just like any other field, there are gray areas, there are hurdles and challenges that architects might be facing in this industry particularly. Could you talk a little about those?
So yes, there is that other side to the profession also, which is sometimes can be discouraging or can be challenging at best. And that is that I find that in our country particularly, compared to the West where I spent considerable time,
right.
That here people still feel that architecture is, they somehow are shy of giving accolades. People are very good at criticizing. I'm talking about when you're dealing with clients, it could be private clients, it could be government clients, it could be committees that you're presenting to. Somehow people here feel that if they criticize something, they have been able to demonstrate their ability in the profession. Very strange insecurity, I feel it sometimes. The other thing here is that we are not somehow allowing architects, or we inhibit the creativity. We always question, has this been done before? But in our profession, that's not necessary. When a Taj Mahal was built, nobody asked, has this been done before?
Right.
Or for that matter, an Eiffel Tower or a Statue of Liberty, or, you know, Burj Khalifa. So you don't have to think. This is a creative profession. There are no boundaries. But in India, sometimes people think in their mindset like this. So that for me is a bit discouraging.
So sometimes I'm sure you must have faced situation where you might be tempted or lured to, you know, be swayed by the monetary considerations versus you might have a very instinctively artistic bent towards certain projects which might be defying the otherwise, you know, monies and the considerations like that. So what do you, in situations like this, what do you do?
So I have always felt that it is the money or the budget cannot be taken as an excuse by an architect to say that, you know, it is stifling my creativity.
Right.
Creativity is not just in relationship to a budget. Creativity is more to do with having the creative freedom,
right,
and the creative urge to,
right,
do something different. The budget can always be subservient to it or can fit into it. So for me, it's never been that way, and therefore I feel that even for aspiring architects, they must think of it like that, that just because the client gives a shoestring budget doesn't mean they have to come out with a shoestring creative solution.
Right now, a lot of youth basically watches our show HopStart and would love to enter this field. So any piece of advice that you would particularly give to them, especially since you're a recruiter, what is it that you look for in new people who are joining your firm?
So my piece of advice would be, very simple, that this is a great profession which has, after doing an architectural degree, you're still open to doing following many pursuits. You don't have to be just a conventional architect who is responsible for creating a building. You could go into computer technology, graphics, interiors. So there are many allied fields that you could still pursue after a degree in architecture, which incidentally is so holistic, because in our courses you learn everything from history to geography to geology to physics to mathematics. Everything is covered in this course. So it's a great course to follow. And to become an architect also, I think there's plenty of opportunity. Like I said, in India, there's so much development to happen both in cities and rural areas. So that is the best part about it. But my one piece of advice definitely would be that enter this profession if you have the passion for it.
Correct.
Because you cannot be successful. I'm sure that might hold true for other professions, many other professions
true.
As well.
Yes.
But certainly for architecture, because it's a tough profession. It takes a lot of hours. It is open to, like I was talking earlier, a lot of criticism for people. You have to present your designs and hear their responses.
Right.
So it is a complex profession because there's art and science angle to it. And at the end of the day, unfortunately, it's not the most paying profession if you were to compare with some of the others. So you really need to be passionate about it if you want to excel.
And perhaps developing a thick skin is also part of that process.
Very, very important. Cannot do without a thick skin in this profession.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, sir. It was a lovely chat. I mean, I personally got to know so much about this industry, and I wish now I can go back in time and, you know, make that choice again and perhaps would want to become an architect after all.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that. But even if you can't, I'm sure you can have many of your viewers at least who are at the cusp of decision making, take a decision and would love to see them as architects.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a lovely chat.
Thank you. My pleasure.
So guys, this is us at CP Kukreja Architects, and I have to say I had such a lovely conversation with Mr. Dikshu Kukreja, who absolutely gave us so much insight into this industry, and I'm sure you guys also benefited a lot from this. In case you have some career advice which you're seeking from us, do write to us at hopstart@ndtv.com, and please do not forget to use hashtag HopStart. See you!